Is it okay? Can you hear me well? Thank you very much for your invitation to London. Actually, it's a nice thought. This is London, to London, although I travel a lot. Apparently, I miss London, usually, because I'm afraid of Heathrow. Anyway, it's great to be here, and I really appreciate that the organizers invited me to speak as well on the topic that probably is known to everyone. And I will try to make it attractive once again. Because I've been here a few years, maybe 10 or 15 years ago, talking to natural language groups on my early studies on the topic. And then probably some of you have heard some of the information that is included in my presentation before. So my intention here is to put it in the context and also outline the challenges for the future, because the challenges are there. And I will also base my presentation in the beginning on the evidence that we have and discuss the advantages and disadvantages of what we know so far. So let me go on and first start on the report that I have not been involved in, but I know that some people from UK and around the world, experts on the topic, were involved in producing the report that was in 2014 published by the Wellbeing Council. So the Wellbeing Council, which is probably more recognized by all the efforts required for sustainability and energy reduction and so on, decided to write a report on health, well-being, and productivity in offices. And in 2014, they published a report. It's available online. Not only that it's available online, all the reference material is available online. So if you want to go and see and challenge some of the results and their conclusions, you can go and read this, all those documents. But what is the most important, it's fantastic context of my talk, because this is probably for the first time they acknowledge that not only energy is important. Although I was talking with some people from World Living Council, it means that their still energy is the highest on their agenda. But here in this report, they say that the framework for organization is to measure how their building impacts on their most valuable asset. And this most valuable asset are their employees. And I don't have to repeat it once again, that buildings are not constructed to save energy. They are constructed for us to perform our work, to learn, or to rest in them. And this is the main, and they basically, by framing this report, they actually acknowledge that. What else they say is they try to compare what we have already known and discussed in the field of indoor environmental quality, was what is the relation between the human cost and the building cost in a building. And again, they acknowledge that the energy cost and the rental cost are minor compared to the staff cost. And what is really important here in this comparison is that if we put a lot of efforts to reduce energy by 10%, 10% variation in energy will only produce the impact on cost of 0.1%. Whereas the 10% variation in the human cost will produce the 10%. So the difference is huge, really. Also, they summarize the all information that is available out there as regards to what are the effects of environmental quality on work. You might debate whether some numbers are really true. I believe 40% increase in retail in daylight. I'm not sure whether this is the right number. I probably, all the shops should have a daylight then. But nevertheless, this is something that has been reported. They tried to put it together and they reported this. And this all is available. Also, what they do is they attempt to propose how to measure performance in the future by suggesting that it should be measured by measuring physical parameters, perceptual parameters, and financial aspects. But they cannot define how performance in the future buildings should be measured. They propose this, and a especially they propose some of the measurements that are now available and feasible. Are they the right one? We are really not sure. Is the absenteeism the right one? Is the staff retention the right one for financial aspects? Is measurement of CO2 the right one? Well, I will let you know in a moment my opinion on that and what the literature says. So basically, if I can summarize what they said, is that they said that not only energy, but non-energy benefits are a low-hanging fruit. And we should aim and get them. We should not forget about them. So, what do we know about? Well, we know a lot. And actually, when you ask people whether they believe that whether indoor environmental quality affects performance, they all admit it does. But no one is actually doing anything to make some calculations, financial estimates of what should be done. So, anyway, so some of that has been published as one of the journal publications, National Journal, that published several questions and answers on the topic of how water quality and temperature affects human performance. For non-specialists, I advise you to go and just download it. Rebar has been also published. Download this. It's probably 1 hour reading, and you will know most of it than I have, than I presented today. And so how this is affecting our performance, how buildings affect our performance. It's pretty simple. It's how we design the building, how we operate them, and how we maintain them. Sometimes we only focus on the aspect of design. So when we believe that we design the buildings correctly, and this is among others included in some of the certification schemes, they actually think only about the design stage of the building. But the operation and the maintenance of buildings are equally important on how the building affects humans. So that it can directly affect humans, or that it could affect the environment, and the environment can affect humans. And then, by affecting us, we can expect either some destruction or some losses, or we can expect some benefits. We can estimate the value of the benefit. So this is the chain how the buildings affect human productivity, human performance. So some still debate, okay, for human the proper performance, satisfaction is generally a very important element. This is a very easy chart, and which summarizes the analysis that was performed on the data that was collected in the United States in about more than 10,000 occupants, probably more than 600 office buildings. And the occupants were asked about the satisfaction with the indoor environment. What are the parameters that affect satisfaction with indoor parameters? And also they were asked how they rate these different parameters affect their performance. So it's a self-estimated performance. If you look on the top of that, this is the list on the left. You see is the list of the parameters that affect their performance, and that the parameters in the top are the top parameters that people think that affect their performance. And these are temperature, noise level, air quality, building maintenance, visual comfort. So parameters that we all know that actually constitute indoor environmental quality. Those are important for our performance. And there is a trivial answer to that. Why they do affect our performance? Because we remember, oh, it was maybe dim, or maybe it was too warm, or maybe it was noisy, I could not work. I hate this because I could not work. So this is why satisfaction with those parameters is so important. But the same people also ask, what other parameters are important for generally their satisfaction in your environment? Temperature, air quality, light is not that important. These are Americans, I'm not space. But nevertheless, what is really important to say is that those parameters are less important. So people do not associate their satisfaction. And if we talk about satisfaction, often facility managers or the building heavy in our music. Should be heavy, so they should have different colors and textures that they like, ease of interaction, they should have a nice furniture, probably they should have free food, free coffee, and so on and so on. Does it mean that they will perform better? We don't know. Probably, maybe to some extent, yes. Yes, but we should not forget about the other parameters. So, those parameters are equally important, or maybe least important, that we talk about performance. So, this is, we know that building affect performance, the parameters defining the domain parameter body are considered to be important for their performance. So, let us go and have a brief overview of what we know. So, what are potential mechanisms? There could be many, and there are a few that with which we can work. So, indirect parameter quality, as in general, can cause destruction and attention. This is an obvious factor that affects our cognitive performance. And here I will call upon designers who think that open plan offices are good for our performance. Perhaps for certain tasks they are good, but perhaps for other tasks they are not good. So very creative office design in the future may have to accept that not always open plan offices to save the space and energy should be designed. Motivation and arousal, neurobehavioral symptoms, here we talk, and acute health symptoms, here we talk about symptoms of the simple symptoms of headache or irritation of perception of others and so on, which may create either physiological effects that affect performance or may also cause destruction. Then there's one parameter that we forget, is the sleep quality. And I don't have time to discuss this today, but the issue, because we are talking about non-residential building, but the issue of how we sleep and performance, and the issue of indoor environmental quality affecting our quality of sleep and performance is going to be a very important issue in the future and study. And I think we need to look at this. There are some evidence, recent evidence published in the Canadian study that shows that working in a green buildings actually improves sleep quality because there's more access to daylight problem. But this is the aspects that we really need to think and consider this a holistic reaction. And then some days. I give you an example. We are now here in the classroom and beautiful, and probably we need to have a little bit of the academic information. So here is the a law that defines the relation between our activity, activation, and performance. And this is the Jerkes-Dodson law that defines that we need a certain activation, stress, we call it arousal or whatever, to perform well. There are some tasks that require higher activation, some tasks that require lower activation. And depending on this activation, we will be then performing better over our lives. But that is an optimal activation for certain tasks to be performed. If these are difficult tasks, but a simple task will be basically higher activation, would better performance. This is now this is one of the potential mechanisms that can explain. And then indoor environment is shown to affect our level of activation. Dim light and bright light, noise and quiet, high temperature, low temperature, they will affect our activation level. And in this way, they can affect our performance. Another mechanism that we work with on the effects of the indoor indoor quality and temperature on human performance is due to the physiological effects. Surprisingly, this mechanism suggests a similar effect or similar mechanism for the elevated temperature and the reduced quality on human performance. So it suggests that when we have a poorer quality, we breathe shallowly. And this is not that we, I mean, we that involuntarily expanding this shallow retort reduced exposure to pollutants in our blood. This will cause insufficient elimination of carbon dioxide from our blood. So EDCO2, which is end-tidal CO2 concentration in our blood, or pH of our blood, should be kept constant. This is very dangerous for our body or for our life if the levels of CO2 in our blood are slightly too high or slightly too low, because it can cause basically it simply die in the end. And the higher levels of CO2 in our blood cause microacidosis, and this will create symptoms of headache, difficulty to concentrate, and irritation that will reduce performance. Apparently, warmth discomfort will also have an effect on a higher metabolic rate, and if there is insufficient elimination of carbon dioxide from our blood, the same cannot happen. And we have evidence that poorer quality and warmth discomfort are causing negative effects on symptoms which are related to performance. So these are some of the mechanisms that are important to mention. I will go on and review some of the areas. So let's talk about office work. What do we know about indoor environment or quality of office work? We know that we can expect the effects of 5 to 10%, usually lower than 5%. However, most of the work that has been done either in lab, only in few studies we have results, from actual real places, obviously. And different types of measurements of performance were used, from a simple physiological indicators, psychological tests of whether we can memorize things, recall things, you know, respond very quickly, and so on, through some measurements of elements or components of office work, such as typing of the text, proofreading, and so on, to more human to the assessments of how we estimate the rate on our own performance. In field studies, mainly self-estimated performance measures were used. So people were asked whether they can assess the performance or not. And also, there were measurements using the existing measures of performance that are used in offices. And there are not so many offices that use existing. There are maybe call centers or maybe insurance companies, but where you can estimate the claim processing time. But otherwise, how do we define office work? It's very difficult. And this huge number or numerous different methods of measuring the performance is actually creating a problem. Because how we rate the performance on the psychological test, on a simple psychological test, against the performance on the more sophisticated tests, such as, against, for example, text typing, or against time that is spent with the customer on the phone. How do we rate that? We don't know. How do we compare those two? So, despite those problems, there have been some relations developed, and then I will just quickly review this and just give you another view. And this is one of the relations that shows how performance of office work, measured by those different aspects, is depending on our supply rate or ventilation rate. It shows few percent change, and the change that is occurring mostly when you have poorer quality or no ventilation. High ventilation will not produce the large effects on performance. But again, it's debated what is one performance of one unit and how we relate this to the real performance. We really don't know. Then, as regards temperature, this is inverted U shape. And whether this is, as shown here, about 22 degrees and nominal temperature for nominal for optimal performance, or whether it is shifted to 23 or 20, maybe a little bit lower, or maybe should be 25 or 26, it all depends on the context, on our level of closing, on our activity, and so on and so on. Nevertheless, here we see that there is an optimal level of temperature for the optimal performance. And probably term to or the right parameter to use for in this context, it should be a thermal sensation bone. Or thermal sensation. A human thermal sensation. And the studies suggest that neutral, the condition of neutrality, thermal neutrality, is not optimal for performance. It should be slightly on the cooler side. Not too cold, not too cool, but slightly on the cooler side to perform well. So this is probably related a little bit to this activation of the human body. So these are the areas for those parameters. There is, you will learn more about probably noise and light effects later, but I just want to say a few words that there are also studies that show relationship between the noise and the office performance, performance on office work. And in these studies, it is not noise level that is used as the measure of performance, but rather noise is used as a distracting factor. And here this distracting factor is measured as a speech transmission index. It's how well we can understand someone speaking in the back or in, and how much it can affect our performance. And the more distraction that we get, the more this, the more negative effects on performance that can be seen. So this is what we know about the work on school. What about schools? I think here is really a challenge for us. Because what is happening is that there's a new growing population that is really facing new challenges and a completely different way of work and a completely different way of living. And do we really support that they are well prepared for their adult life? Apparently, probably not, because we are not very good in creating conditions, especially for children in elementary schools, that will allow them to fully develop their skills. And the evidence from elementary schools, from classrooms, from classes at the level grade 5, grade 3, grade 6, where they have to develop those important skills, they have to know how to use math, they have to know how to read, how to understand, and so on, so on, and how to express themselves afterwards, then these basic skills probably are affected. So, and the effects are bigger than in the office. You can see that we're talking about 15-20%, generally no laboratory studies. And laboratory studies are difficult to make with children. Children will perform too good in the laboratory to show that they can do it. Apparently, Japanese can do it the same, and many of the studies from Japan show the same. But it is the case that very few, if any, laboratory studies. But there are studies in field in classrooms, but using different metrics of performance, of learning in schools. And these are psychological tests, schools, typical school tasks, and also standardized national tests. Also, absence risk is used in this context. Each of these elements is affected by the indoor environment. This is an example of the recent study that was published in 2015, where they looked at the performance on the psychological tests of elevated temperatures and the poorer quality I'll show you in a moment. There are two different psychological tests, gravity tests and track tests, but generally they measure attention and concentration, and they show, you can see two different curves actually here, for one test and the other test, two different optimal temperatures, because they require two different levels of activation, as I said before. But generally what is the most important is, again, the U-shaped curve and the showing that there is an important relation or association between the temperature and the performance of psychological tests by children. As for the air quality, apparently the studies show that there's a linear relation between the performance of psychological tests and also this is in relation to carbon dioxide. And also show that those tests are affected maybe to a lower magnitude, but they are affected. Again, typical school tasks. Temperature affects typical school tasks. These are typical units of calculation or math units when they have to add numbers. This is a reading speed and reading understanding of the text and the so these are affected, and the effects are bigger than for the similar tasks that are performed by the adults. And this is the temperature, this is I just briefly go through them on the expense of time, but also it's just to illustrate that there is evidence. You can go there and you can actually pull the data and use them in your discussions with anyone. And these data are based on the, I don't have this time to discuss, but these are on the numerous studies that, that are published in the literature. And I have been acknowledged as the standard. And also, so psychological tests, so the simple, very simple tests, looking at the skills of children and abilities. Then the simple tests, the tasks in schools that children sometimes exercises in schools that children have to perform, but also standardized tests that are developed by the educational department. They try to look at the how learning is developing over time, and also those tests apparently are affected by conditions in classrooms. And this is a relation that shows how the graduation rate affects the number of students that pass the test, and please note these are low levels. These are about 2 to 10 meters higher than the test. So it's actually low level. Offices will never go that low. And then for the temperature, also there is an effect of elevated temperature resulting in negative. Recently, I would really like to, maybe not, very few of you have tried. Was recently a report published by the Harvard School of Economics by Pawel, who actually looked at the tests from the secondary schools of pupils in New York State, and then or actually New York City, and then he found that temperatures of 32 degrees. In comparison, temperature of 72 degrees, ambient temperatures against the temperatures of 23 show again that there is an effect, the long-term effect of exposure to higher temperatures on the performance on tests, and there is also an immediate effect of the temperatures, of elevated temperatures, on number of pupils that pass the test. So this is an important issue, really, and it's now confirmed by several studies. Is anyone checking this?
Yeah,
7 minutes. Oh, that's okay, great. And then if you look at the evidence, if we summarize all the evidence, we also need to look at the absence rate. It's about 1 to 2 days, usually. And then there are relationships that are developed. I'm not sure. You know, there are very few studies based on which those relationships are developed. This is the one for the absence rate, short-term absence rate in offices in relation to absence rate, or graduation rate. And this is based mainly on modeling and few, basically 4 or 5 studies that were published today. And they basically show that you can expect significant effects if the graduation rate is much low. And the mechanism here is probably different. It's basically is the infection that is caused by the pool of population. Also, in schools, there are more and more studies that are popping up that show that the ventilation rate in schools is affecting the absence rates of children. Of course, it's, to be debated is whether the child can catch up at a later stage, and what is the relationship absence rate in school and learning performance. Nevertheless, there are some studies that show that the poorer quality, poorer ventilation associated with that will affect the absence rate and increase the absence rate in schools. Although the magnitude of this effect is different across different studies, some of them show higher, some of them show lower, probably about 1% reduction or 1%. It's more or less this is what you would expect. So last 5 minutes, the most probably interesting part of it. So this is the evidence that we know. The question is, so how we proceed, how we advance from today? Do we know everything? Actually, we don't know everything. So the first question that we all know, which pollutants are associated with the effects on performance? The second question is, what about adaptive thermal comfort model? Can we allow for the adaptive thermal comfort model? Or we should strictly define the zone of comfort? Then what about green buildings? Do they promote performance? Improve productivity? And the most important questions in that, probably, the last the two bullet points that you probably don't see even because they are slightly too, but the sleep and the combined effects of different IVR, I don't have time to discuss, also very important. But two important at this moment is how we can rely on measure the effects of performance. And I think this is crucial at this moment because if we do not, we are not able to measure properly as we measure energy. We don't have a performance thermometer. We cannot go there and say, well, we measure performance like this. Unless we measure this, it will be very difficult for us to implement the relationships that I showed you. And then the next important, the last bullet on this is, can the evidence on the effects of IQ on performance be used in economic calculations? And that goes together with how we measure. So how we can use those relationships in economic calculations. I mean, I think the facility managers, constructors, architects, and they would really like to use it, but they really have a problem. What means the performance for those relations that I showed? They really do. So, first about what type of pollutants. Recently, there was there were two studies published in the literature that show the carbon dioxide, elevated levels of carbon dioxide, pure carbon dioxide. We are not talking about other pollutants. Carbon dioxide is negatively affecting some aspects of cognitive performance. And this aspect is the decision, so-called decision-making performance. So higher cognitive skills in which so the slightly elevated carbon dioxide level can affect how well we make decisions. There are two studies, and there's a lot of interest in that. Two reasons for that is that we found the guilty one. This is one of the reasons. We can measure the guilty one. This is the second reason. Third reason probably is that this is a highly cognitive demanding task. So people like managers, you know, people who are responsible for people, other people, they may be affected. So the consequences of poorer quality can be significant. And should we believe in that or not? We don't have any other evidence that this is not true. Though, we have an evidence from the series of studies that were published after that, that maybe the levels of CO2 only, the CO2 is not affecting simple cognitive tasks. This is very difficult to understand, but just to illustrate that, is that simple cognitive tasks are not affected at the same levels of carbon dioxide. And so this is the result that is actually different from what was published in the two American studies on the decision-making performance. It does not mean that those studies use different types of measurements of cognitive performance. So, in certain situations, if the decision making is important, perhaps CO2 is also important. But otherwise, we don't know. Also, we know that effects of CO2 will appear first above 5,000 ppm. They observe the effects at levels of 1,000 and 2,000 for the cognitive performance on decision making. So, really, there is a debate going on. We should not, you know, jump directly into the conclusion. The most important conclusion is that CO2 is only a marker have marker of other pollutants. So by controlling CO2 and removing it from a space, we are not probably removing other pollutants. So we should be also concerned about the other pollutants. So this is, also during those studies, we were able to develop the relation, the exposure response relationship for bioeffluents, human bioeffluents. So human bioeffluents are important indoors, and they may affect cognitive performance. Apparently, at the levels of human bioeffluents, which are represented by the CO2 at 3000 ppm and above, we would expect negative effects on performance. Yes? 1 minute, okay. Another important issue is thermal, adaptive thermal comfort. So, the basic principles of adaptive thermal comfort is that we can psychologically adapt to the elevated temperature. Or we can do some behavioral measures to adapt to the elevated temperature. So, I want to say that psychological adaptation to the thermal environment does not mean that it's not a thermal comfort. Maybe there could be negative physiological effects associated with this, and that's documented in the literature. So, on this ground, allowing temperature to drift is probably dangerous in a sense, or risky, because it may negatively affect the performance if the physiological parameters, the physiological effects appear. Secondly, often it's not possible to make any adaptive measures, like say adapt our clothing or open the window to reduce the to actually mitigate the effects of elevated temperature. Finally, the way how we adapt is that we reduce our metabolic rate. So in order to feel less warm, we will reduce our metabolic rate and we will reduce the working speed of heat. So then in this way, that adaptive thermal comfort may negatively affect our performance. So we should be very careful in looking at this. And then, before I finish, I want to say that we should be also very, very careful in using so-called self-estimated performance. So now questionnaires are, everyone is using questionnaires. Right? Whenever you buy something, then you get a pop-up mail. How do you like our delivery? How do you like that program? This is so popular now. And also, we tend to use this method of measuring our performance. And there's more and more studies popping up showing that self-estimated performance is used and is often correlated with some changes in the environment. However, there's no evidence that objectively measured performance correlates with the self-estimated performance. This is one of the examples which shows that self-estimated performance is affected significantly. Objective measured performance, the other one, is not affected. So I stop there now. So because I want to say this is a very important point. So finally, these are my conclusions and takeaways, which actually summarize what I said. I always produce too much, but there's so much to say. But for those who really interested, I want to say again, there are papers that are published. This is a paper on question and answers. There is a creative and productive workplace book that is now being updated. Next year there is a new edition by Derek Clemens Crew. I suggest you go to it. It's going to be a fantastic reference. There's a RIVA guidebook on some economic calculations, so you can actually refer to those selected readings, and then I see.